Chapter 14, Molly. It's getting dark, Molly said. Maybe we should stop here. It's tricky enough flying in daylight.
It's really just jumping, Anna corrected her.
Still tricky. Molly glanced at Yoshi, who didn't seem remotely surprised by all of this talking of flying. When Anna had demonstrated the gravity device for him, he'd only nodded. Maybe a little thing like anti-gravity didn't seem strange to the discoverer of Tanglevine.
Hang on, Javi said. You want to spend the night out here?
Molly nodded. It's better than crashing through the trees in the dark.
I'd rather be in the trees than down with the carnivorous
vines, Javi looked accusingly at the undergrowth.
And who knows what else comes out at night in this place.
We can't fly blind, Molly said. Anna nodded in agreement.
Two words. Shredder birds?
Not fun in the dark.
That was seven words, Javi said. And what about the predators down there?
Everyone looked at Molly.
We build a fire, she said, trying to sound certain. That will keep us safe.
She led the four of them to a bare, rocky outcrop. No one wanted to camp anywhere near the thick undergrowth, even with the roar of the waterfall a good distance away. Obviously, the Tanglevine hunted near watering holes, but Yoshi had said he sensed it before he'd reached the falls. They collected kindling along the way, and the fire starter soon had it smoldering. The night hadn't turned cold yet, but an open flame seemed to scare off the animals in the place. The ones they'd met so far, anyway. Maybe the nighttime had a whole new batch of predators. Molly put that thought aside. What they needed was a way to fly home without being shredded. Tomorrow we'll jump lower, she said. If we stay below the treetops, we can hit the dirt much quicker if the birds appear.
Sure, Javi said. But what if the dirt has Tanglevine lurking in it?
Molly didn't answer. She was too busy trying to ignore the food bar in his hand. She was saving her own to eat right before sleep. Living with her mother had taught her that nothing was worse than waking up hungry in the middle of the night.
I can handle the vine, Yoshi said, and went back to cleaning his sword.
He was buffing it with a yellow cloth, the movement hypnotic in the growing firelight. After a solid minute of polishing, he inspected it from all angles, then pulled out a tiny plastic bottle. Squeezing a few drops of oil onto the blade, he began to rub it into the steel.
Molly suddenly understood.
Your sword isn't rust-proof,
Yoshi nodded.
It was forged 400 years ago.
Stainless steel wasn't a thing.
Whoa, Javi said through his food bar.
So you have to clean it every time you use it?
Even a speck of moisture could make it rust. Molly wondered how many drops of oil were in that little bottle. Probably not as many as there were monsters in this jungle. She wondered when exactly she'd given up on the idea of help arriving and why. Maybe because a rescue squad of Canadian Mounties didn't fit in with shredder birds and plants that tried to eat you? Yeah, that was probably it. When they got back to the plane, how were they going to explain all this to Oliver? The buzz of the jungle grew louder as the sky darkened, and a few of the glowing blue insects drifted into camp. Molly stared into the black trees, wondering again what new threats were out there. They should make a schedule for keeping watch through the night. But if she brought that up, everyone would go to sleep imagining unknown monsters. None of them would get any rest. Molly sighed. It was up to her to stay awake, to keep watch without telling the others. She could sleep tomorrow in the safety of the aircraft cabin. She ran her fingers through her hair. Anywhere else she would be freaking out, wondering how to get it cut to mask the singed parts. But here it hardly seemed to matter.
I thought of a way to signal everyone back at camp, Anna said, to let them know we're okay.
Molly looked up from the fire.
That would be great. Oliver must be worried sick.
We can signal him. Anna held up a bundle of twigs. We turn the gravity off, set this on fire, then throw it 2,000 feet in the air, like shooting up a flare.
That's almost half a mile, Javi said. How do we manage that?
Check it out. Anna stood up and tossed the bundle of twigs straight into the air. She took a few steps, staring up into the darkness, and caught the bundle two-handed as it fell back to earth.
Maybe 20 feet, Javi said.
Right, Molly calculated, wishing Oliver was here. So you're saying low G lets us throw stuff 100 times higher?
Anna nodded. From a standstill, I can jump maybe a yard, and we're jumping a few 100 feet at a time. That's 100-to-1 ratio.
But we tested the anti-gravity bubble. It's only about 30 feet across, Molly said.
Across, yes.
Anna held up the device. But the first time I turned it on, Javi jumped way higher than that. The low G zone might only be 30 feet across, but I think it goes all the way up. It's a cylinder, not a bubble.
Huh.
Molly closed her eyes, remembering Javi floating high above the trees, the emergency door tumbling to the ground. Why would anyone design it that way?
Maybe they didn't have a choice.
Anna placed a fist over the fire so that it was lit by the glow. Gravity comes from the earth, right? It reaches up like the light from this fire and pulls us down. She put her other hand underneath, palm out flat, blocking the firelight from her fist. So maybe that device makes a gravity shadow. Everything above it is almost weightless because it's cut off from the earth.
Javi let out a groan and fell back onto the stone. That makes sense, but it also hurts my head.
But gravity doesn't shine. It warps space. Molly shook her head, realizing that everything she knew about relativity came from extra credit questions and TV shows. Still, I guess it's the same idea.
How do you guys know all this stuff?
Yoshi spoke up. He had sheathed his sword and was staring at Anna's shadow first.
We don't know anything, Anna said with a shrug. We're just theorizing.
But we're engineers. We were flying to Tokyo for a robot thing. Molly tried to say it in an offhand way, like Team Killbot flew to Japanese robotics conferences all the time. But Yoshi didn't quite look as impressed as she'd expected.
Engineers? He said, then gave a grunt. Then why hasn't it occurred to you that we might be on a spaceship?
They all stared at him.
A what?
Molly sputtered.
Think about it, Yoshi said calmly.
Shielding the gravity from a whole planet would need some serious hardware, and that device is the size of a frisbee.
So,
Molly asked.
So, in a spaceship, the gravity is artificial. You don't have to change the laws of physics, you just have to turn something off.
When no one reacted, Yoshi gave a tired sigh.
In other words, maybe it's not a gravity device at all, maybe it's just a remote control.
Molly stared, wondering if Yoshi's day alone in the jungle had addled his mind somehow, or if he'd eaten some kind of psychedelic plant. He held up his radio, and I heard something on this, something kind of transmission.
Really?
Molly said. We haven't gotten anything but static.
Yoshi turned his radio on, and the familiar hiss came out.
Me either, but back at the waterfall, there was a beeping,
a pattern.
On a spaceship, there would be a navigational signal, right?
Molly turned to Javi and Anna, silently appealing for help.
This place doesn't have any actual sky, Javi said softly. Just mist.
Anna nodded. Like someone's trying to hide the ceiling.
Molly stared at them both.
What? I mean, yeah, all of this is really weird, but why would there be a jungle on an alien spaceship?
Instead of answering her, both of them looked at Yoshi. He shrugged.
If you can build a ship big enough, why not put a jungle in it?
Plants create oxygen.
Exactly the right amount of oxygen for humans to breathe?
Molly asked.
Maybe they made a few adjustments. They clearly don't want to kill us.
They don't?
Molly cried. Did you miss the part with the carnivorous plant?
Yoshi spread his hands.
They're testing us. If you kidnap some local primitives, isn't that what you would do?
I wouldn't kidnap people in the first place, Molly cried.
She turned again to Javi and Anna.
Since when do you guys believe in alien abduction?
Javi shrugged.
Since something grabbed our plane and stuck us in this weird jungle, more or less.
Molly, a plant tried to eat us, Anna said calmly.
And a red jungle?
On Earth, almost everything does photosynthesis is green. It's like these plants evolved under a different sun.
Molly let out an exasperated sigh, wondering when exactly they'd all gone nuts.
You had to gather hard data before you came to conclusions, especially ridiculous ones.
Listen, Molly, I'm not saying we're on a spaceship, Anna said. But whatever is going on is at least that weird. I mean, do you have a non-weird theory?
Molly stared into the fire for a moment before answering.
I think we're on Earth. Because we can breathe, and the gravity is the same. I think our plane went off course because there was some weird new technology in the hold, and we crashed someplace no one's ever been before. A lost island or a valley deep in the Amazon that was never discovered before because it's always covered in mist. She stood up and looked into the dark sky. And I think I can prove it. Javi rose from the fire and stood beside her. You think there are stars up there? Yep. Watch this. Molly jumped as hard as she could, straight up. How high? About 2 feet. Molly nodded. Sounds right. And with a boost from the rest of you, I bet I could do twice that. 4 feet multiplied by 100 should be high enough to get above any mist. But you'll be bird bait up there, Javi said, and you won't be able to turn off that device without splattering yourself. Not to mention landing on us, Anna added. I'll take a flare, Molly said. It's worth the risk to know something about where we are. Otherwise, this place is going to drive us all crazy. They all stared at her until Javi sighed and said, Okay, guys, everyone up. A few minutes later, Anna, Javi, and Yoshi stood in a tight circle next to the fire. Their hands were interlinked in the middle, like they were ready to give someone a boost over a fence. Molly put one hand on Javi's shoulder, then rested her right foot carefully onto the 6 overlapping palms. With her other hand, she turned on the gravity device. The sickening elevator drop feeling hit her in the stomach, and the fire made a popping noise. A few burning pieces of wood wafted into the air. Oops, heat rises, Molly thought. But that problem would be solved once she had the device. Once she and the device were lofted above the flames. The anti-gravity effect might go all the way up, but it only extended about 15 feet in every other direction, including down. 1, 2, 3, she cried, and pushed herself up with all the strength of her arms and legs. The others grunted in unison, and a moment later, Molly was hurtling straight up into the night sky. The firelight quickly shrank below, and soon the jungle itself disappeared, wreathed in mist and darkness. At first, Molly felt suspended in formless space. The only sense of motion came from damp tendrils of wind brushing her face, the air growing cooler as she rose. But soon she realized that the mist was thinning around her, and finally she saw a few pinpricks of light in the inky darkness above. Stars in the night sky, beautiful and perfect. They weren't on a spaceship after all. Molly smiled. This was Earth, which meant there was some chance of getting home. She couldn't wait to tell Yoshi that his alien abduction theory was just as silly as it sounded. But then as she felt her ascent coming to an end and the long, slow fall beginning, Molly saw something else in the sky. 2 things, in fact, close together. For a moment, she thought they were aircraft lights, but they were too big. And one was a crescent shape. And as she fell back into the mists, Molly realized what they were. Pair of moons, one red, one green.